the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. To order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Amazing grace. Praise.
this can't stay any longer. Your perfect love is casting out fear. You are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life is healed. Sickness can't stay, sickness can't stay. His face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of His love.
Welcome to the Christian Center Church Podcast. If you would like to sow into this ministry, you can do so at the link below. Thank you for joining us, and we hope the message today will bless you.
This morning I want to minister a little while, the divine vine, amen. Are y'all abiding in the vine, amen? You know, we've seen that song, Abiding in the Vine. You know, that was an old staple, man. Everybody was singing, and a lot of people were singing about the vine, didn't even know who the vine was, what the vine was about, amen. You know, Jesus taught the way of the divine vine, amen. You know, he taught the keeper of it, and he taught the keeper of it. And he also spoke, most pointedly, he spoke about the fruit of the branches. You know, the fruit's real important, can you say amen? You know me, when you get into gardening, you get into putting something in a bucket, I get excited, amen, because I found out how to succeed where I failed, amen. And I found out it needs the fruit on that vine needs a source, can you say amen? I want to ask you this morning, as I get going this morning, who's your source this morning? Now look at me now, come on, that's right, Sister Jesus, that's right. Give God glory, that's what I ask, I got to ask, amen. But you know, some grandkids is their grandparents is their source. Some kids, their parents, and they grow, and their parents is their source. I was telling Brother Mike about a lady went to my church, always paid her tithes. She called them tithes, is what she called them. She said, I'm going to pay my tithes. And she always paid them. And she had a stroke, aneurysm when she was young. And at that time, I didn't think she was young, but she was young. And she had a very small amount that she lived off of. $600-$700, Social Security, SSI, whatever, for what she had. And you know, she had sons that were working in Lake Charles, and they were making $1,000 a week. And about every other week, they had to borrow $40 from mama to make it to work. Y'all listening to me this morning? And she'd go into church, and Jesus is her source. And you know what she'd do about once a year, or maybe other year? She'd say, Brother Jerry, can you bless my tithes? And give them back to me. I need to pay my house insurance. I said, baby, yes, we will. We bless those and give them. Let me tell you, if he's your source, he's your source. You won't go looking nowhere else. You'll look unto him and believe. Come on, somebody. And she outdone the rest, amen, making thousands of dollars. But a week or two later, for the next payday, you got to get $20 to get to work. It's sad, isn't it? Well, there's a lot of people like that, amen. When we consider, you know, that what God has done, and Jesus began to talk about the vine, and we'll talk about the source of those fruits, but you got to consider this now, that it takes a layout for a vineyard. A vineyard takes a layout. It takes time. Yet somebody's going to have, if you really want to see the fruit of the Spirit in your life, and if you really want to see the fruit of the Spirit in the church, you got to put in a little investment. You got to put in a little time with the King. Can somebody say amen? You know, the vineyard, in fact, is the only branch of agriculture, and I'm not saying that in pun, it's the only branch of agriculture that must be enclosed. Now think about that. That he's the vine, and when you looked at, everybody knew what Jesus was talking about when he began to talk about the vine. Everybody around him knew. They had products of the vine, grapes and wine, and grapes by themselves, and wine, and whatever comes, and the goodness, and the super healthiness of eating such a thing. But it takes effort. Sometimes you have to put a hedge around your joy. Sometimes you have to hedge around, amen, what God's doing in your life. And that enclosure, and it has a, but what I really want to point out with that, and we'll get to the time, but you know that, but what the vineyard was actually a community thing. Not only did the owner of the vineyard able to receive, but those others were able to receive at this time. How many of y'all know that we ought to be a community church? We ought to be a people that touch the community with the word of God. Amen. And we have to share it and go. You know, let me say it this way. Without Jesus, we are hopeless. But with Jesus, how many things we can do? We can do all things through Christ. He does what? That strengthens us. You know, Mark 16 said, go into the world and preach to every creature. Said, get up, go do something. Go that way. Everybody should have that ministry. Everybody should talk about Jesus. Everybody should lift him up. I'm going to tell you, when I go to Whataburger, Whataburger, or Wendy's Burger, and somebody is praying, I notice when somebody's blessing their food over there. And I see some of them kind of look uncomfortable, and you see some of them, they're doing it, amen. Then I see a couple of the kids is praying. You ever get your kids to pray? Daddy, I want a puppy. Well, no, we ain't praying for puppies right now, Daddy. But you know, in Leviticus 19:9, it says that when you reap your harvest, that you shall not reap the corners of the field, nor shall you gather the gleanings of your harvest. The Hebrew word gleaning means to collect. He said, a certain time you harvest, you leave. So, you know, in the blessing of what God does, there ought to be something left for others around us. That there ought to be an ability to give and love without coming up in deficit of what we have. There should be some on the corners and the edge of this thing. Oh, my goodness. There ought to be something on the edge of this thing that people are receiving, not just people sitting in the building, but people around the building and in the community ought to be receiving because there's something coming off the vine. Can you say amen? You know, when wheat and barley fields were harvested, you know, they were allowed it to fall on the ground. And whatever would fall on the ground was provisions for some people. And it was just a surplus for those who were in the know, those had the ability to invest, those that had the labor ethic to get out and do something. Come on, or the work ethic, can somebody say? You know, Proverbs 19:7 said, one who's gracious to the poor and lends to the Lord, he that repayeth, he in his good deeds. Amplified says this way, it might read a little better. He said, who is gracious that lends a hand to the poor? Lends to the Lord, and the Lord will repay him for his good deeds. He said, you get invest, you do something, you invest in them, and God's going to invest in you. You know, it's our nature to only be invested in what we see as a increase. So what you going to do? Oh, I'm going to get away. I'm never going to see nothing. We're not much on that. But you know what the Bible said? He that pulls in and holds it, he finds lack. He said, but he that scatters abroad, he finds increase. The church ought to have increase. Not just in the church, but we should affect our community. When you're at the store, you're pumping your gas, whatever you're doing, you just be a blessing the way you want to be a blessing. It's good. Lifting up Jesus. But it should go past the vineyard of the owner. It should go past and seep into the neighborhood. Can you say amen? You know, when people love the community and all that was going on at this time, it was happening. Let me tell you that the people were expecting a harvest. Are you expecting a harvest? But I'll tell you, you can go down there when the blooms is on, you're not going to get much bloom. Now, you can eat some blooms, amen. You can actually eat any rose you want to eat, amen. They're good for food, amen. May not taste that pretty as they look, amen. But Leviticus 19:23-25 says this. And he was laying out, Leviticus was laying out the course of time to receive something. When he talked about trees and vineyards, he's talking about it. He said, and when you enter into the land and plant all kinds of trees for food, then shall you consider their fruit forbidden or unclean. For 3 years the fruit shall be forbidden unto you, and you shall not eat it. You know, now he's talking about trees for food. He's talking about citrus. He's talking about olives. He's talking about fig trees. He's talking about vineyards. But who knows that he's talking about you planting them. He's talking about you being involved. He's talking about Israel being involved. He said, but there's a course of time. You know, sometimes people get in church and set a little bit, and the first 3 months ain't on, they got to move a little bit. Somebody, let me tell you what, it takes time for a vineyard or for a harvest to come. It's going to be perennial. It's going to be every year. Now, the things that he's mentioning, the things that Leviticus was mentioning, the writer of Leviticus was mentioning, were things that are perennial. That means they come every year. They go every year. They go every year. You know, in some parts of the world, where trees never really stop bearing. They just continue to put on more blooms. They don't see a winter. They're in a continuous cycle. But yet there is abundant cycle even in that. It is. And the 24th verse says, it said, in the fourth year, all the fruit shall be holy, an offering to praise the Lord. In the fifth year, you may eat the fruit of the trees, and it is as they're what they yield, and you may have increase to you. I am the Lord. Now, he said, now after the fourth year, it's going to be unto the Lord. Now, in this meantime, you got to understand that they're plucking away fruit. They're plucking it away. Let me tell you, sometimes when things get uncomfortable, God's doing something for you. Can you say amen? Sometimes when you really don't like what's going on, that old flesh has to do. Let me tell you what, in the 3 years of the planting, nothing's happened. And the vine dressers dispose of it, to get rid of it. You know, I found that early fruit, I never forsake, only if I have to. If I buy tomato plants or pepper plants, I don't care for them to have blooms or peppers or anything on. I don't care for that. And the fact that they have them, I break them off. I take them off. Because the plant can't sustain the fruit in a way that's going to be long term. That's them little plants. You see them to get to, oh, I got two or three off of it. But if you plucked it, cleaned it up, and fed it, which some people don't do, they don't invest in it. And it makes all the difference. It begins to move. It begins to flourish. It begins to hold to the roots, and the roots get stronger. As I taught you before, you know, no roots, no fruits. Let me tell you, Jesus is rooted and grounded in the will of the Father. Amen. Jesus is unmovable. Can you say amen? You know, in the fourth year was to the Lord, and to give straight for the Lord. The fourth year that they give straight to the Lord, only after the fifth year. Now, guess what year I'm in here? I'm looking for something to happen. Not just because I'm my fifth year, but I just thought it'd be a good thing to put my foot in and just go and get to walking with it. Amen. Now, some people going the other way because 3 days they didn't see anything. They got gone. Well, I went ahead and walked 4 days, 5 days. I'm going to walk into it. Can you say amen? You know, one of my kids, you know, we was riding at night, and they asked me, Daddy, why is the moon following us? Sometimes you got to grow up, amen. Sometimes you got to understand that we ought to have something that is holy to the Lord. Now, he said in that fifth year, something happened. He said, now you can do this. And in the fifth year of this product, it was a time now that would move. How many know 5 is the number of grace? And we got to take to heart that the true vine takes time, and you have to have a present. Somebody said present. Investment. And I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about spirits. I'm talking about prayer. I'm talking about getting here. Oh, it could be that. But let me tell you, if you're not willing to be present in what he's doing out there, you're not going to be much present in here. But if you're willing to be present out there, let me tell you, when you get in here, it's an easy thing. We're in our environment. This is our house. Can you say amen? You know, and the word of God ought to come out of this house, and the word of God ought to go out and touch this community because the word, not who's preaching it, because of the word. Can you say amen? It don't matter who's preaching. It matters who the preacher they're talking about. Can you say amen? But you know, the nature of the spirit, we have to consider now in a spiritual sense what's going on in the natural. And in the natural, they have things as training. They train it and have a training system. They have a system of pruning. They have techniques. They have irrigation. They have soil quality. And you, who knows, you got to have a climate because you can't grow certain things in certain. You can't grow a mustards and peas in the desert. But that's what some people say. You know, they say they don't like rain. He said, I don't like rain. I like rain. Me, I'm a rainy day sleeping man. I like to hear that rain. Some people say, I just don't. Let me tell you what. If you never have rain in your life, you live in a desert. If you never have rain, you live in a desert. Amen. And some things have to have conditions. And you need to get here where the word is poured out, or get somewhere where the word is poured out. And you need to be nurtured. You need to be pruned. You need to have some. Come on. If I sound like your buddy every week, I'm not preaching for your money. I'm here to preach for your soul. I ain't preaching for your money. I'm preaching for your soul. Say, all right, he said that every time he talk about getting somebody. I hope so. We ought to be talking about getting people. We ought to talk about somebody witnessing Jesus. We ought to talk about our fruit is from Jesus and who he is. Amen. But it's a proper time and a proper season that a fruit will produce in our lives. Now look at me real quick and I'm going on. You know, in my counseling days, I found out that, you know, when people get married, I know that's a strange concept today, but people got married. And when they got married, about the fourth year, they started trying to change people. Well, I thought you did not do that. I thought you quit that hunting. I thought you quit that fish. I thought you quit going to your mother's. About the fifth year, it's true. About the fifth year, people start trying to change their mate and start forming them into things they were because they done got past the honeymoon, done found out that this is what I got. And now that they can't make it better, they try to make the other person something else. It's amazing to me how women in the church, I've seen it many times, women in the church go get them a bad boy out there and bring him to church. And when he gets saved, want to serve Jesus, they don't like bad boys no more. Well, he ain't a bad boy no more. He's a good boy. Oh, that's true. That's true. Somebody in the back. Hey, man, I believe it. Isn't it that when they get right, that something's going to change? And that's in that year. Let me tell you, if we'll stay the course, the fruit's coming. Stay the course. Amen. Go with me to John 15, the first verse. Finally, we're getting here. Proper time, proper season. There shall be a producing of the fruit of the vine. You know, and we have to wait in that time. The first verse. He said, I am the true vine. The church said, true vine. Now, there must be some fake ones. Man told me, he said, I believe there's false prophets. Let me tell you, if there's a false one, got to be a real one. Must be a real one. Everybody told me, he said, okay, I'm going. I am the true vine. My Father is the husband, and every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it that it may bring forth more fruit. Amplified. He said, every branch in me. And the church said, in me. Now he said, he's making it clear. Now he's not talking about being on your own. When he starts talking about a fruit manifestation, he's not talking about the manifestation out of yourself. He said, in me does not bear fruit. He takes it away. Every branch that continues to bear fruit, he repeatedly prunes so that it will bear more fruit, even richer and finer fruit. You know what he's saying? Now, you know what that is? Sometimes that uncomfortable time. Sometimes it don't feel like that. Sometimes you don't feel like getting up. Sometimes you don't feel like praying. Sometimes the things you don't feel like forgiving. Sometimes, come on, somebody, help me. And he said, what he do? He purge you. He'll peach you off a little bit. He'll prune you a little bit. Now they got one that's being taken away, and they got one that's being pruned. And you know, whenever he says take it away, Jesus spoke such eloquent with the Greek and began to speak. And as he spoke, you know what this word actually means? This word actually means to make amends. No, excuse me. Actually means to make doubt. It means in its form, to remove that which is unproductive. Now he's removing the unproductive. And when he moves something from the vine that's unproductive, when he's moving this and he's doing it, the very same word is to make doubt. So what he's doing, he takes away that which makes doubt and causes the vine to be unproductive. Then he prunes that makes it amends, it repairs. Now the same word meaning guilt or wrongdoing. Now, this man's talking about fruit. What he's talking about bearing fruit. He's talking about spiritual fruit. He's talking about something. He's talking about on another level. And they understood that. So he's talking about this as taken away. What's taken away? It means doubt when you see it, but it actually means to be unproductive. And it means the guilt or wrongdoing. The action to making amends for the wrong that has been done by providing payment for the wrong. So what he's saying, he said, I'm going to cut you out. I've made the price. I paid it. And I'm going to make it better. You know, when God's really working on you, yeah, people, oh, man, when I first got here, man, I was on kite 9, kite 12. I jump off kite, cloud 9 on the kite 12, and I was up in the air. Can you say amen? But after a while, you know, I had to settle down and come down, and it seemed like he spent a lot of time showing me what was wrong with me. Not condemning me, but loving me and showing me. And he's still working on me. Can you say amen? He's still purging. He's still doing that. And let me tell you, sometimes it's not a question if God's doing it. It's a question if I'll let him do it. Amen. You're doing that when he's after you. Look like you in the Matrix or something. Third verse. Now, I know those words didn't seem like they go along with the language, but read the next verse. He said, now you are clean through the words which I have spoken unto you. Just what he's talking about, cleaning, cutting, talking about set free, talking about removing something. He said, now you're clean. You don't have to worry about it. He said, abide in me and I in you as the branches cannot bear fruit in themselves. Except it abide in the vine no more than you, except you abide in me. Rule one, vine reliance, not self reliance. You're wondering why you can't do it? You know, I gave a list of the commandments of Jesus, and some of y'all's eyes got about that big and wondered if you'd gonna be able to. Let me tell you, Jesus makes up what we can't do. Can you say amen? He's still working on us. Can you say amen? I'm relying upon him. Sometimes I fail, but I gotta rely upon him. You're relying on religion, it's going to fail you. I tell the sad story. I went to see the man. I didn't know him that well, but I went to see him. I'm still excited about Jesus. I'm still excited about being saved. I'm still excited about having your sins. Well, I get a little more excited about that glorified body, but I'm going to tell you, I get excited about this. And I went to see this man, and I talked to him about his soul, and you know what he told me? He said, sir, my mother was a very religious woman. He's planning on going to heaven behind his mother. I was young. I didn't know what to say. I thought of 1,000 things to tell him now. If you're going to witness somebody, you need to be prepared. Can you say amen? You need to be vine reliant, not self reliant. How many of you have been self reliant? I know it feels good. You're your own man, and all that. And ladies, they don't work with you so good. I was coming down the road and I was praying. I got to thinking about those transgenders. I said, what are they going to do because their transmission is tore up? When Jesus comes, are they going to be able to move? I'm just wondering. I'm going back over here. No, I'm going that way. Nah, I got that transmission tore up. It's something. Yes, sir. Fourth verse in the Amplified says this. He said, remain in me and I'll remain in you. Now he said, get out and I'll get out. That's what he said, like he said. He said, remain in me and I'll remain. No, this is the thing. If you for sure stay in, I'm for sure committed. He's committed. He's trying to tell you he's committed. You get committed, he's already committed. I'll be committed. He said, just as no branch can bear fruit in its own without remaining in the vine, neither can you bear fruit, producing evidence of your faith, unless you remain in me. Self-reliance is unproductive. Now, he told me, he said, you can do it if you stay in me. So is this the reason why the body of Christ can't get some things done? Because we're not in him. Now, can I be honest with you? You know, most people won't get involved unless it's something for them, like I said. Let me tell you, look at me. Jesus got involved with you for nothing. He got involved with you for that. You had nothing to offer, nothing, but he got invested in you. And now he said, just stay in me. Now it's going to work out. He's going to purge. He's going to prune. He's going to make it uncomfortable sometimes. But you know what? I found out I had some tomato plants, and I had them, and these was pretty, and they was looking pretty nice. And then I got some, and I got them. And when I peached these and did these didn't do as well because I hadn't had them for a month. And the ones that I did purge just jumped, man. They jumped up the next 2 days. And the other ones, because of the root system, because the treatment of it, because what it had, you know what, the energy was in there to restore the branches. I want you to know, you may go through something, but there's an energy in the vine. His name is Jesus, and it's stored in him. And when things happen, he'll just, but if there's nothing there to get, and I could tell the difference. And I said, man, I like mess those up. But what the deal was, it was the investment in that vine. Can you say amen? John 15 and 5. He said, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. He said, without me you can do nothing. You know what the word abide means? It means to stay. It means to remain. It means to be. It doesn't mean be wishy-washy. It doesn't mean to be undecided. It doesn't mean to be in the valley of indecision all the time. He says, remain, you stay with me. You know, I look back, and I'm just going to be honest with you. There's some things I prayed for I didn't get. And you know, a few years later, I found out, thank God, I didn't get them. And just because I can see it in some things and don't see it in others, it does not mean that God was not on the real with me the whole time. Can you say amen? Just because I can't see it, sometimes you can see it. But let me tell you, when you can't see it, God's still in charge. Amen. Have you ever heard some people say, me and Jesus got our own thing going? Let me tell you, that's a very unscriptural thing they got going. Amen. Because he said, come unto me. He talked about us being a many-membered body. He said, hey, he's talking about us being a vine. Does that say, no, something that's by itself can't produce. It cannot produce. Now, you know, Jesus has been imitated, but never duplicated. Many people can be that kind and know and be that, but you can't duplicate Jesus, can you say? He's unique and the only one, amen. Glory. You know, Galatians 1:8 says, through 9, I think, maybe it's just 8, I'm sorry. Galatians 1:8, he says, but if there were an angel from heaven should preach unto you a gospel contrary or different from the one which I preach to you, let him be accursed, devastated with destruction, doomed to eternal punishment. You know what he said? They come with a different one that Jesus, there's not going to be an imitator getting anybody to heaven. He's the true vine, the only vine. Well, Brother Jerry, you know, I think if you do this, no, I'm telling you wrong. If you're not totally dependent upon Jesus, I'm a Jesus-only man. Can you say amen? It's not popular some places I go. It takes their power from them, they think, you know. But, you know, when branches are pruned, they're pruned for the good. You know, when God works on you, it's for the good. Not the bad, but for the good. How many believe that? Unproductive branches taken away. You know, most gardeners understand the most important part of pruning. As I said, you know, the branches, unless they're dealt with, the branches that are unproductive, and I go in and I just clean them up. You know what they do? They begin to rob from the vine. The unproductive. The ones that don't want. The ones that needs to be taken out. You know what it does? It just pulls nutrients from the vine. Just pulls from the rest. Can you see me? Oh, what you're saying, brother? No, I'm telling you, in a natural understanding, that a vine has to be trained. A vine has to be in the correct environment. A vine has to have certain sources. You can't plant a vine in concrete. I guess you can, but it's not going to do much. Yes, you can. So we know that, to be unproductive. You know, pruning leads to more fruit. You know, when Christians, we got to understand that it's for our convenience, not for our inconvenience. So we feel that when God just prunes us a little bit, and God trims us up and gets on us a little bit at church. I often think about the little lady sitting on the front row, and the preacher was preaching against adultery and everything. They screaming and hollering, and she got to talking about snuff. He got to talking about snuff. She got real quiet. After church, he said, sister, what happened? I seemed to lose you along the way. She said, well, you was doing good till you started talking about that snuff and you quit preaching and started meddling in my business. Some people feel the business is meddling. He knew what was wrong with her, did he not? Amen. Well, and you know, the truth is this. When you go through difficult times, you're going to have to hold to the vine. No use turning loose. No getting no. Just hold to the vine. Pull the source. Believe he's going to do something. Believe that he's in. How many of you believe he's got your back? How many of you believe he's really in charge of your life? How many of you, let me tell you what he's over. You ready? He's over everything you give him and nothing that you will not. But I don't understand, Brother Jerry. They seem to do it. Well, they gave it to him. It's true. You know, Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. How many of you believe that? I believe that. But Brother Greg, why do we try? Why do we try? You say, well, Brother, I don't really try. Well, you do whenever you're trying to approach it from a non-scriptural thing. You do whenever you're going against your scriptural Bible sense. You're going away. You're going across, going over. Can you say amen? And the vine gives life to the branches and the power to produce. You got to understand what God wants from your life, what he wants for your life. He does not want it from you. He wants it from the source of himself. What do you mean, Brother Jay? Because you know, this is where he's trying to bring us. You know that Jesus said, I am the Father's one. He said, you seen me. He said, you seen me, you seen the Father. Said, I do what he said does. I see whatever he's doing, I do what he does. I say what he says. He calls us to be in him. If you remain in me and I in you, it makes the difference. You can't do it on your own. Let me tell you, I tried, amen. I tried just to be nice. Nice is not good enough for some people, can you say amen? But you know what? What we should plan, have manifest, is that we're going to have fruit, and it's going to come through Jesus. It's going to come because I'm abiding in the vine. It's going to come because I'm holding my place. It's coming because I've been purged a little bit. It's coming because God knows what he's doing. Oh, it's a hard pill sometimes. When things not going your way, it's hard to believe God's in charge. But he is. But he is. You know that when you need to be pruned, that could be something you do for yourself. Amen. Verse 6. And if any man abide not in me, now here comes the downside. Any man that abide not in me, he casts forth as a branch that's withered. And men gather them and cast them into the fire, for they are burned. Now, you got to understand the ones not abiding, they're going. Now, it's different from the ones that's not having the source. He's cleaning. He's now you clean through it. He do a little cleanup. Can you say amen? You know, I've cleaned them up. I've cleaned them up and got them ready to go. They didn't look like much when I got through with them. But let me tell you, in about 3 or 4 days, if they're healthy, they just start doing that. Let me tell you, if you allow him, if you will allow him to purge, if you allow him to take away from you, just like me or anybody else, that he'll allow, let me tell you, a fruit to come, increase to come. He said, if a man abide in me, if not, he's cast forth, he's withered. Cast, the word here means to be broke up. It means to dry. It means to be broke off and to dry. But you know what that word, it comes back to the spiritual word it actually means to pine. He pineth over them. You know what? You're familiar with the word. Pine, it means to have pity for. It means to cry. That in the taking away of the ones that's not abiding in him, you could actually say that he says, I pine when I take them away. It affects him. He doesn't do it just because you're not making the grade. He's not doing it just because didn't that. It he sees the loss of that person. Isn't it amazing? We know what church does. They do it the other way. It's us and them. Let me tell you what. It'll be no more of us if we don't go get some of them. It'll be no more of us. And you know that broke transmission business is nothing but population control at its roots. They ain't going to have any more kids. They continue the lifestyle. They won't have children. They'll be after somebody's children. And you know what they're going to do? They're going to go and get them while the church watch them take them. We, the church, needs to stand up and witness to the young, to the lost and the undone, them in the ditch, and them with pink hair. Oh, somebody ought to give God glory because y'all, I know y'all, brother, did that. Whoo, that hurt a little bit. Brother Don's grinning at me. He ain't saying nothing, but he's grinning. I know the little pinch got you there. I know little lid got you. That's the way it feels. You know, your best Christian face, you looked at me. I love you guys. Amen. I tell you, I'm not here for your money. I'm here for your soul. That's true. You know, I know some of you got to forgive me on Sundays. Nah, I'm messing with you. Thank you. Amen. Sixth verse. He said, if a man abide not in me, I'm sorry, it means the pine of the way. Seventh verse. He said, if you abide in me and my words Here's the kicker. My words abide in you. He said, you can ask what you will and it shall be done. The church said, shall be done. Now, we got to be careful now. We'll get all trouble. What's Jesus really saying? Now, let me tell you, Jesus is not referring to things, stuff, healing, or even getting saved. Jesus is talking about producing the spirit fruit of Christ in our life. He got us clean. He took it. He gave us forgiveness. He's working it. Now he's going to increase. And let me tell you what. You'll never find apples on a banana tree. Not naturally. You won't. And you'll never find anything but spiritual fruit. Jesus said, I am the vine. He's the divine vine. Can somebody say amen? Yes, amen. He's not referring. What Jesus is referring to is a spiritual fruit that is connected to the vine. The result of abiding in the vine, you can bear fruit. This is what he's talking about. He's talking about bearing fruit. He's not talking about getting stuff. I mean, I used it to get stuff too. But I tell you what, we're in need of more than stuff. We're in need of a manifestation of the Spirit of God. We're in need of a manifestation of God in the last day. I'm looking for a Joel day. Can you say amen? Woo! I'm still working on it, man. I'm going to get past this and get this going. And let me tell you, we're going to pray for some kids. We're going to believe for somebody to get saved. Where are we going? Eighth verse. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. Galatians 5:22-23 says, for the fruit of the Spirit is joy, it's love, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. As such things, there is no law. Now, that's the fruit of the Spirit. That's what he does. That sound like he's wanting stuff? He's wanting a manifestation of him. That vine can only produce the nature, the fruit. The vine can only produce a fruit with the nature of the vine. You don't find nobody else in Jesus and I got bitter. You may have was in something, but you wasn't in Jesus when you got bitter. Well, we're going on. You know, he's telling us here. We understand the true power of the vine is in love. How many of you know I guess it's a suggestion for some, but we know it's a commandment. Ninth verse. He said, as the Father loved me, so have I loved you. This is a love issue. He said, now he's trying to get us to the manifestation of that fruit. He's trying to get something happen. He said, I love you if you continue in my love. Now, he's not saying that I don't love you anymore. What he's saying, for this to really happen, you're going to have to co-join me. He's not saying that you don't, you're out. He's saying, if you're doing it, I'm with you. And if you're not doing it, I'm not with it. That's what he said. Amen. 12th verse. Is that where I'm at? 12th verse? What verse am I on? Huh? 10. Thank you. If you keep my commandments, you abide in my love, even as my Father kept, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and also abide in his love. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. You know what that means? That means nailing up, baby. That's nailing up. Now, it's not like you transferring your madness on somebody else. It's not like you not dealing with it. You know what? You hang it up, baby. I don't like it no better than you like it. But let me tell you, when I'm in love with the Master and he's really got hold of my heart, I love whenever I decide to go the way he told me to go instead of the way I want to go. But when I'm struggling with me, it don't feel that good. Can you say amen? I know. I'll just be honest with you. Divine love is the proof of the divine vine. You cannot have divine love outside of divine vine. You know why you can't make it happen? You're not hanging out in the vine. You're not manifestation. You're not having one. Yeah, what? Yeah, what? You're not having a manifestation of the fruit in Christ. I mean, you just tried to just works your way through it and says, I'm just not going to say nothing. I'm just not going to fool with them. No, you're in the wrong spirit, bro. Let me tell you what. If you love me like Jesus, you ready? If you love me like Jesus, I can't do anything to you to stop you from loving me. If you love me like Jesus. Now, if you don't love me like Jesus, I'm going to hurt your feelings with salt and pepper. I'm going to hurt your feelings. It's coming. Guarantee you. When you're at a point you can't forgive, you're at a point you can't go on, you're not loving in Jesus, and you're not abiding in the vine. Said, Brother Jerry was on us this Sunday. Well, I hope be back next Sunday. I'll be here all week. Give his own self a hand. Amen. He said, my command is that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love have no man than this, that is that a man lay his life down for his friends. You mean to tell me I'm supposed to die for them? Just according to what he said. I'm going on what he said. Do you think he lives to literal death? Well, there's no sacrifice can be made. Jesus, he's not telling us to go and die for people to make them feel better. That's not what he's telling. He's telling you die out for yourself, resurrecting Christ Jesus. You know, a lot of people died with Jesus. You just ain't resurrected up. Well, you don't act like and talk like and feel like. Come on now. I'm trusting Jesus. I know what I'm saying. Well, act like you say. He said that you are my friends. He said, if you do whatsoever I command you. Now you know it's a different level. When you get in the fruit and you start abiding and you start doing, you go into relationship levels. Now you call your friend. You know what this word means, the word friend means here? This word friend means associate. But he said, you are now my associate. You know, associates, they got a big lawyer name and the lawyer name, but they got associates under there. You know, you may have a big oil company, but they got associates under there. Amen. I tell you, we got a King of Kings and a Lord of Lords. We got a water walking Jesus that we are associates with. Him. He said, if you stay with me, he said, I'm going to take you next level and make you an associate. I'm going to put you in the firm. Can you say amen? Thenceforth, I call you no more servants, for servants know not what the Lord doeth. Now, that's the difference. I believe some people saved, but they don't know what he's going to do. Don't know what he's talking about most of the time. I said, what happened, Brother Jerry? You know, yes, sir, I'm going to go on. I almost run a rabbit, but I'm back. But henceforth, I call you no more servants. Servants know not what his Lord doeth, but I call you friends. For all things that I've heard of my Father, I have made none unto you. Isn't that good that he doesn't hold back anything? He said, what I'm knowing, I'm telling. Glory. Now I want to ask you, what you know, are you telling? Jesus says, I'm telling what he told me. I want to know, are you telling what he told you? Because the church is going to be a community. Let me tell you, when the time came for the vines, that the people came out and it was such joy and the kids was excited and it's fixing to happen and the harvest is coming in, and they knew no matter who you were, you had the money you could buy in, but if you were so poor and didn't know, out on the edge, let me tell you, the people on the outside of the church, people on the outside of this community are to be reaping from what God is doing in this church and man and in your life. You are to be. And I know that sounded like you're going to have to be involved, but yeah, you are. And here's the kicker. You've not chose me, but I chose you and ordained you that you should go forth and bring forth fruit and that your fruit should remain. Isn't that good? Isn't that good that your efforts pay off? He said, and whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he'll give you. Now, he's not talking about things now. He's talking about a manifestation of the divine vine. You know, the people asking for stuff, but they're not asking to be like Jesus. They're not asking to do something that's going to change people's lives. You know how much people have prayed to get stuff and how little we prayed to get souls? Well, you get your own prayer list down, look at it. And you tell me. I can just speak by experience. You know what I have to do? I have to be conscious that I pray for y'all. I have to be conscious I pray for this area. I have to make an effort and invest my prayer life in this place. Not just my four no more, but invest in what God's doing in this community. Amen. Yeah, again, he's not asking for things. He's asking for productivity. Y'all quiet this morning on me a little bit, but I would take this in the past days and I'd close out by now. But I got a few more minutes here. You know what we have to do is have an intention to move forward Jesus. We have to have an intention to take marching orders. Down here and get these orders. We're going to go out and go into highways, byways, compel them. One translation, Miller translation, that's a good translation. It says, worry them to death till they come. Said worry them. Actually, that word actually means give them a black eye, just like the same as the widow woman. Give them a black eye. It means to look like they've been in a scuff. All right, well, Jesus is Lord, all right? I guess we're scuffing demons, amen. All right. I want you to come, Miss Maddie. Verse 17, he said, these things I have commanded you, that you love one another. You know, the fulfillment of the commandment is that we must stay connected to Jesus. How many of you believe? Won't you stand with me this morning? How many believe that if you stay connected to Jesus, things will happen and things will change? You know what I found out? And I'm going to tell you, I found out pretty early. I can't save people. I can't heal people. Come on. I'm not going to lead people's lives because I probably could lead some of them. I say they're going so bad, I guess I could say, come back this way. But that's not my job. My job is to lay the word before you. Jesus said, you are clean through the words that I spoke to you. So it's not about you being good. It's a manifest. You said, but Jay, I don't feel peace. Well, you ought to hold into the vine. Next week, maybe we'll break it out of it. Break it down if the Lord tarries. And he says the same. But you know what he wants? He wants you to love people just like he loved you. He wants you to have a concern. Listen to that, man. Have a concern about somebody like you concerned to those people that you love the most. It's not hard to want mama to go to heaven. It's not hard to want mama to go to heaven. It's not hard to get my kids and my greats and my grands. It's not hard to believe for them. But the wife beater, he needs Jesus. The drunk, he needs Jesus. The people with all these sordid lifestyles, unlike Jesus, need Jesus. So he wants you to do, you know, he just wants you to go down there and fruit up. Just go out there and be some juicy fruit, baby. Let me tell you, if you abide, something will change. This guy asked me the other day, he said, Brother Jerry, are you still preaching? I said, am I still alive? He said, well, when you think you're going to retire? I said, probably where they find me laying. That's probably. Woo! There you go, sister. My dream is the rapture. These things I command you, that you love one another. You know, to fulfill this commandment, we have to stay in Jesus. And just because, listen to me, just because today I didn't want to be kind or lack to be gentle with you doesn't mean I'm out of the vine. There's just no manifestation of the fruit. Amen. You're not failed ultimately. We all stumble. We all miss it. I say I do. Maybe speak for yourself. But the commandment here is to stay connected. When you don't feel well, stay connected. You don't feel healthy, stay connected. When your friends are no longer your friends, stay connected. Indeed, to hold to the vine, and you're helpless. I'm helpless. We can't do it without him. He said, if you abide in me, and I abide in you. Now, he wasn't questioning if he would. He's saying that. Now, this is the deal. If you stay in me, I'm going to stay in you. I'm helpless. Everyone on the sound of my voice is helpless to have a manifestation of the true fruit of God. It is helpless without him. There's so many people that are outwardly religious, that are outwardly. And man, they say some of the same things, the very same things. Sometimes I try to not talk country, but I tell you, I am. But you know the process of it, that you're going to have Jesus. He said, without me, you can do nothing. How many of you really believe that? But some people outwardly are religious, and they say some of the same things that we know, but they have no relationship with Jesus. We're talking in the hall. Brother Micah did a really good job Wednesday night. Should be in here. Maybe we'll put him on repeat one day. I don't know. But you know that Jesus is working if you let him work. And you know, and as we talk, we talk about people that we've seen and manifestation. I've had great men of God, then I've had not so great a men of God. First time I ever had a failure in the man of God, I learned to get over young. Him and his wife married 40, 50 years. I mean, it was a forever, looked like. And he left and took a young woman. She's calling me. I don't even know what to do with the one I got. I don't know what to tell you. I'm about 30 years old. Oh, you know, he went away from her. But you know, after he went out and he found out, you know what he did? He came back. And the kingdom received the man of God back. They said, well, that disqualified him. Well, you can call it disqualified if you want to. That's you. But let me tell you, I was glad to see him come back to the kingdom. I was glad to see him come back to his wife. I was glad to see. And he would sing that song, Lily in the Valley. Oh, my goodness. Next week, run off with a woman. Let me tell you, church folks, you need Jesus to keep you. You need Jesus to hold you. You need to be challenged every now and then. Because there's no way that you can do these things without staying connected to Jesus. You're going to have to stay connected to him. Now look, here come. When you're connected to him, that means you're connected to me. I know that's good news for some of us. I don't know about everybody. But you know, God is working in people's lives maybe for years, days, and months. Sometimes you just got to yield and say, oh Lord, what do you want to do? And you know, sometimes people subconsciously resist the word. They resist the Lord. I don't think anyone's bad, but I think it takes an effort. He said, if you remain in me, he said, something's going to happen. If you remain in me, things change, things happen. How many believe things can change and happen for you this morning? I said, have me believe. You know, Jesus loves and gives the divine power to love from the divine vine. So you're not in it by yourself. I know some people can't love about four or five people, and I understand it. Most leadership can't love over three people. I know, but I'm doing a little better. I got 3.5. And I thank y'all again for praying for our grandbabies and all. They coming along. I held the little one. I held the little girl. I held her the first time. She didn't have any bones in it. Didn't have no bones in it. I said, this thing ain't got bones in it. This thing be tender. In about 2 weeks, I told her to mama, I said, it's got bones in it now. And watch it grow. You know, I think the Father sees us like that and how we grow and where we are and how silly and how little things make you happy and how you really get a little hot over that because somebody flicked your pigtail. You hot and mad now. I tell you that he loves you. I tell you, divide in the vine. Let us abide in this vine. Let us abide, not turn loose. I believe we're going to see a manifestation. Amen? Father, we just come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God, for being the answer, the truth, the life, and the way. And Father God, we come to you, and we just want to come to that place that we hug you tighter, Lord God, and hold on to it. And Father, we ask you to cut away and purge by your own wisdom. And today, Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Father God, for what you're doing in the future. And we ask, Father God, just let us get invested. We ask, Father, that you let us get involved. And we thank you, Father God, without you, we'd fail. But with you, will succeed and do great things, we thank you. This day, Father, we bless your people spiritually, physically, mentally, financially. We speak good things into their life, and we speak the change of the Messiah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Give the Lord a big hand clap of praise this morning.